for Christmas. Do you know what to expect? I know my mother-in-law, Kim's mom, used to go before Christmas and unwrap presents and wrap them back up. Because she was so curious, she had such high expectation, until Christmas morning she had no expectation. Because she knew exactly what she was getting. What do you expect for Christmas? Let's pray. God, open our hearts and our minds to hear what your word has to say to your people today. It is Advent, Christmas, Lord, a time where we focus especially on what that all meant and what that means and what that will mean, that you have come to dwell among us. In Jesus' name, amen. I love the expectation of Christmas. I always have. In fact, for me growing up on the west side of Columbus, Ohio, with a divorced single mother and two older brothers, we didn't have a lot, but we also didn't seem to want for anything either. It seemed like whatever we had was enough, and somehow my mother was able to have Christmas gifts for us. And to give you the picture of my great expectations at Christmas time, and I was the youngest, which, how many of you are the youngest child in your family? So you all are the perfect ones also. Fantastic. Amen. Actually, you're the ones who got to get away with more than your older siblings. Isn't that right?
Amen.
So down the hallway, it was into the living room, and the Christmas tree, we always got the biggest live Christmas tree we could find. There was the Christmas tree. You could see it clear down the hallway. Here's my bedroom. Here's my two brothers' bedroom. They shared one together. My mom's bedroom and the bathroom, all down at the end of this hallway. And so on Christmas Eve, there were a few presents around the tree. But on Christmas morning, it was so different. Why? Because Santa had come. And all of a sudden, there's a bunch more presents under the tree. And so I was often the first one to wake up with great expectation of what that was even going to look like. But when I came out of my bedroom to go use the restroom, I had to do it like this. Right? Not allowed to look down until everybody's up and ready to go. Not allowed to even see the tree. And so I would go like this. Because my expectation was too great. Go to the restroom, I'd make lots of noise to make sure I woke up my brother, both my brothers and my mom, and she would get up, she would go out in the living room, then my two brothers and I, we would come out and we'd line up in the hallway. And now we can see it. We're allowed to look at it now. And my mom would pause a little bit. And she'd go, "All right, go." And we literally ran all the way down the hallway, dove into the tree. I was on the right, Phil was in the middle, Rick was on the left. Every year, never changed. Huh. We knew where our presents were, and we literally would just start tearing things open with great expectation. And then once we opened everything and kind of played with it a little bit and had some lunch eventually, then there was more expectation. Can I ask how many of you come from a divorced home? Raise your hand if you do. Okay, there's lots of us, right? For me, that wasn't such a bad thing at Christmas because what? Now we get to go over to Dad's house and more presents. So as a kid at Christmas time, you kind of had two of those on time. Now there was no lining up or anything. It was just going in and you see it and so forth, and you bet you go and open it. But there's always expectation of what there would be for Christmas. I expected to see Ma and Paul on Christmas Eve. Phil and Donna Graham. My grandmother and my grandfather, they lived at Point Place, and every Christmas Eve they drove down to Columbus to be with us. Either late Christmas Eve or early Christmas morning, they'd get up and drive to my cousins in Oxford. But I loved seeing them. I always had that great expectation of spending a little bit of time with them at Christmas. I expected to go to downtown Lazarus in Columbus and go to the sixth floor where the real Santa was. The one where you walk through kind of this magical land and then you finally get to him and get your pictures taken and all that. And then to go down to the basement of Lazarus and go into Secret Santa. They would take cash. Imagine that. Cash. Put it in an envelope. Pin it to the child. So I'd have this envelope pinned to me. And I'd go through a door that's about this tall. It was designed for kids. And once you go in, Santa's helpers are in. And inside your envelope is cash and how much money you can spend on each person in your family. And they help you shop for presents that you can get with that amount of money, and then they help you wrap them. So your family, even if you're a six-year-old, your family doesn't know what they're getting from you. So they get some expectation. I expected to go and see the windows at Lazarus. They had the animated stuff that just as a kid, I just looked forward to that and all the Christmas lights downtown. I expected to see Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer that came out in 1964 and a Charlie Brown Christmas that came out in 65. How the Grinch Stole Christmas that came out in 66. And so these are all coming out right when I'm 5, 6, 7 years old. Perfect time. And Frosty the Snowman that came out in 69. I think two of those at least were on last night, maybe. Then, kind of shared last week a little bit, once I came to know Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, I had a different expectation. In 1974, I had the expectation of the reality of now what was no longer a holiday, but now a holy day. A holy day about the birth of God's Son. And then in later years, after getting married, I had the expectation with children of seeing their joy on a Christmas morning and their expectations like I had. And now I get to kind of revisit that again, that I have a grandchild. So I have expectations for that as well. Some people expect this to be a time of great financial stress. You don't have the money you'd like to purchase things for people, but you also, because of your love, want to bless them with things or the things they want. And so it can become a time of great financial stress. It can become a difficult time with family issues, with families getting together, and some just maybe don't want to get together. It certainly is a time of missing loved ones. It can be a time of depression. It can be an extreme time of loneliness, even with all the stuff going on around us. But no matter how you look at it, Christmas is a time of expectations. Christmas has always been, is, and will be a time of expectations. So I ask you once again, what do you expect for Christmas? In 1744, let's go back more than a couple hundred years, a guy named Charles Wesley considered a particular scripture text, and this is our text for the morning's message. And so listen closely to Haggai chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. Again, I love finding these texts that we don't normally see as Christmas texts. It's not the Luke 2 or the Matthew passage. Haggai 2, 6 and 7. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all nations, and the desired of all nations will come, and I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. The hymn writer, Charles Wesley, looked at the situation of orphans in the areas around him. He also looked at the great class divide in Great Britain at the time. And through this train of thought and looking at this particular text, he wrote a prayer. And then later in that same year, 1744, he added music to it, and these are the words that came out of that. Born your people to deliver. Born a child and yet a king. Born to reign in us forever. Now your gracious kingdom bring. By your own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By your all-sufficient merit, raise us to your glorious throne. Amen. Have you ever sung that?
This morning.
Thank you. You sang that this morning. I was hoping somebody would say that, because it's a song I think that, unless we really think about the words, we can just kind of sing and go on and skip it. But what powerful words they are, both in the hymn as well as the scripture text. Wesley adapted it to this music and made it a great hymn of the church. He wrote with the Advent Nativity in mind, but as well to prepare people for the expected second coming of Jesus. Yes. And am I on?
Is this microphone on?
Fantastic. Is that better? Did you hear me well enough that I don't have to start over?
cue card. Big Simon said, "Bite." Appreciate it.
The hymn became popular across Christian denominations in England through a popular Baptist preacher named Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Spurgeon preached a Christmas sermon in London in 1855 when he was 21 years old. And he included sections, that was about 90 years after the hymn was written, he included sections of "Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus" to illustrate the point that very few are born king. And only one was born king who had not first been a prince. Now, not that he was born and became a king. Jesus was already king eternal. Think about that. He was already the king. And then he was born. Wow. Nobody was expecting that for Christmas. Some expected that a person would be born and would be anointed by God to be the Messiah, much like a prophet or a king would have been. No one could have even considered that God himself would become the Messiah in flesh, the pre-incarnate anointed one. What does that mean? For those who were here last week, we weren't going to explain it. We had about a 2-minute video clip of my ordination service 30-some years ago, where the church conferred and recognized that I was ordained by God to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Well, I wasn't ordained in that moment. I was ordained by God to do that prior to that moment. That was the church recognizing it. Does that make sense? God did it already. And the church agreed with God. That's a good thing. Well, the same thing. Jesus was king already. Jesus was Messiah already. He was the anointed one already. And then he was born. He wasn't born and became the king. He was the king and was born as such. Let's talk about temple glory as it refers to the text we're looking at in Haggai. Haggai moves the people to compare the glory of Solomon's temple that was built with costly materials to the current temple that was built with available materials. So Solomon's temple was glorious, lots of gold, just everything so beautiful, the most beautiful building anywhere around, right there on the Temple Mount in Israel, and it had been destroyed. And about 16 years before Haggai, they start, where we are in this text, they start rebuilding the temple. It's not anywhere near as beautiful. It's not as big. It's not as glorious as that one was. The previous is far greater than the current. It's also the time of year when Haggai is speaking here, when the temple needs to be built. It needs to be finished. And it's not. It's the time of the greatest feast of the year for the Jews. And they don't have that fully completed place to come and worship and offer sacrifice. Haggai makes the people see that it's not the structure that brings the glory. And that's hard for Jewish people because the structure itself was so closely related to God's presence and God's glory. He filled his temple with glory. They say that over and over and over again. And so it is about the place. It is about the structure. But Haggai, he gets it. He says it's not about that. Rather, it's about the one who dwells there. And that the glory is as strong now as it was when the greater looking temple was here. It says, in fact, it may be even stronger now. The presence of the Lord Almighty consumes the majority of Haggai's text. And it gives the people hope to finish, to be renewed, to be strengthened. Because the glory of God's going to come fill it no matter what it looks like, no matter how big it is, no matter what materials are used. God's glory will still come and inhabit the temple. Haggai calls this disgruntled, discouraged community to work with renewed strength and without fear because the presence of God is coming. The great expectation of the first Christmas, for those who were aware, God, the angels, eventually the shepherds, was that God was coming to earth. The expectation of this Christmas ought to be just as strong of an expectation that the Messiah is coming to dwell in people. And I don't mean just people who already know him, but people who don't yet know him. That's what our expectation ought to be about. Jesus is always looking for another manger, another temple in which he can take up residence and fill that space with his glory. There are many people who say, no, I can't go to church. Thanks for the invitation, but I can't because the ceiling would fall in. No, I can't go. I'll start going, or I'll start believing in Jesus once I get some things straightened out in my life, once I'm doing things better. Well, that would be like saying, no, we can't take the stable. We're not going to lay our baby in a feeding trough because we need to wait for something greater, something much better, because he's the king. There was none of that. It was, at that point, we'll go wherever you can go. Jesus will fill any space with his glory, no matter how humble, no matter how downtrodden, no matter how seemingly far away from him you feel. He wants to draw close to you. You don't have to be a glorious, beautiful temple like the ones you might compare yourself to that are around you, that probably aren't as glorious as you think. Right?
Oh.
Right? Probably aren't as great as you think. God wants to come and fill your space with his glory. The Bible says that you are a temple of the Holy Spirit, that he wants to come and dwell in you. Let's look a little bit at some people who expected some things. Mary expected Jesus, didn't she? Luke chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, to the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. The world didn't know, but she knew, didn't she? Joseph knew, didn't he? Again, eventually the shepherds knew, didn't they? Those wise guys, they knew. They knew who this child was, that he was someone special. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. She gave birth to her firstborn, a son, wrapped him in cloths, placed him in the manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Mary expected Jesus. A little bit later in life, Jairus, a captain of the guard whose child had taken ill, actually ultimately died. Here's the scene, Luke 8, verse 40. Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. And ultimately, in that story, Jesus goes and raises Jairus' daughter from the dead. Matthew chapter 11, verse 1 through 5. After Jesus had finished instructing his 12 disciples, he went on from there to teach and preach in the towns of Galilee. When John heard, this is John the Baptist, when John heard in prison what Christ was doing, he sent his disciples to ask him, are you the one who was to come, or should we expect someone else? Do you think John was really asking that question legitimately? Do you think he really wondered if Jesus was the one, or did he already know that Jesus was the one? Of course he already knew that Jesus was the Messiah, the anointed one. He's asking the question, really, to find out what's going on. Jesus, I'm in prison. What's going on with you out there? Are people getting it? And Jesus says, go back and report to John what you hear and see. So he's turning people into evangelists right now. He says, go tell them that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, the good news is preached to the poor. John knows who Jesus is, and now he knows that it's starting to happen, that the glory is starting to spread. And so, him being in prison and about to lose his head over it is all worth it. Let me ask you a question. Do you expect Jesus to come again? He said he's going to. Do you expect him to come again? I'm not sure exactly. I think about that. 100% I expect Jesus to come again. Do I expect Jesus to come again during my lifetime? I'm not so sure. Can he? Yep. In fact, he's going to come when we least expect it. Right? The rule of thumb is to be ready.
Luke chapter 12, 39. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known the hour the thief was coming, he would not let his house be broken into. Right? He'd been there. He'd been ready. Well, you also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come in an hour when you do not expect him. Say, well, he's going to come soon because there's wars and there's famine and there's all kinds of problems and promiscuity and everything. As it has been since the time of Jesus, there is nothing new under the sun. It is no different today than it was then. Read the letter to the Corinthians, and you'll see that. Read the scriptures, and you'll see that there have always been wars and rumors of wars and all that stuff going on. So the signs of the times that people like to use and say, well, obviously Jesus is coming soon. No. The disciples thought he was coming soon. They didn't even write anything down. We didn't get the gospel until 40 years later. Because there was no need to write it down, because Jesus was coming back soon. Well, soon to God is God soon. And for us, it will be at a time when we do not expect it. And so, because of what I just said, I do expect that Jesus will come during my lifetime, because I don't expect that he'll come during my lifetime. If you didn't get that, you can ask the person next to you. Any of you ever been to the U.S. National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C.? There is a series of four paintings there by a man by the name of Thomas Cole, and they're called The Voyage of Life. And each painting depicts a stage of life: childhood, youth, manhood, and old age. The first painting is of childhood. It shows a mountain with a dark cave at its base, a river flowing out of the cave. A beautiful timber boat glides out of the cave into a world of lush vegetation. Flowers in bloom, peaceful, gentle surface on the water. Inside the boat is a laughing boy with a guardian spirit, or the presence of God, standing right behind him. The painting shows childhood as a time of wonder and joy and closeness to God. The second painting is called Youth. We see the same boat now traveling further downstream. The baby has grown into a teenage boy. He stands in the rear, confidently steering the boat toward a majestic white castle off in the distance. The riverbanks are still lush and green, and the guardian spirit stands on those banks a little bit further away from the boy. Watching the young man boldly chart his course, the painting shows youth as a time of dreaming and absolute self-confidence that nothing can hold me back. And in the third painting, the scene has changed dramatically. The youth has become a man. The river has become a raging torrent. The sky has become dark and threatening. The castle of dreams is nowhere to be seen, and the boat's rudder has broken. Up ahead lie treacherous rocks, white water crashing all around him. The man in the boat is caught up by forces he can't control. With the rudder broken, he cannot steer his boat. All he can do is look up to the sky and pray. Meanwhile, the guardian spirit, yet further away, sits hidden in the clouds. Cole is picturing adulthood as a time when joy and wonder of childhood have been tamed by the difficult and tragic experiences of life, when the confidence, boldness, and expectations of youth have been swept away by the harsh realities of life. Finally, a painting called Old Age. The battered and weathered boat has finally reached the ocean. The dark clouds remain, but the water is still. The boat's occupant is now an old man. His gaze is fixed firmly on the clouds out there in front of him, clouds pierced by the glorious light of heaven, the light pierced by angels coming to and fro. For the first time in his life, the man sees the guardian spirit, or the presence of God, that has accompanied him on his journey. It comes eventually and takes him by the hand and prepares him for his journey to heaven. In each of these stages of life, the man in the boat had expectations. Sometimes the expectations were wonderful, full of promise. Other times they were fearful, full of dread. What should our expectation be this Christmas and into the new year? Is it full of wonder and joy and possibility, or is it dread? What should our expectation of Christmas be
Don't answer that. Let me answer it for you. I usually like you to figure things out for yourself, but I want to answer the question for you. What should you expect for Christmas? You should expect the glory of Jesus in and through you for the sake of others. In you to fill you that are his temple, through you to seek out other temples where God might dwell and take up residence with his glory. That is what you should expect for Christmas. Alex read for us Psalm 5, verses 1 through 3, so invite the message here again. Give ear to my words, O Lord, consider my sighing. Listen to my cry for help, my King and my God. To you I pray in the morning, O Lord, you hear my voice. In the morning I lay my request before you with great expectation. The Feast of St. Andrew invites us to ponder his response, Andrew's response to Christ's call, come and follow me and I will make you a fisher of men. At once they left their nets, says Matthew 4:19. With his brother Peter, Andrew immediately left the fishing nets to go catch souls for the kingdom of God. Are we hesitating to respond to Christ this Advent, this Christmas, because we have a low expectation of what Christ can do through us? Do some of us look back at the glory days at the greater temple? Right? I know I didn't show it last week. I forgot. But for those of you who got on Facebook and saw the Monday message review, you saw me with pictures of me in front of the Ashland Avenue Baptist Church building. Oh, glorious building. Yes? Absolutely. Held way more glory physically. But isn't the truth that it's about the Spirit of God who dwells there? Haggai says, there's no point, people, in comparing the past to the present. It doesn't do us any good. What we need to do is to look at this moment and into the future and see what God is doing. That doesn't mean discard the past, love the past, be thankful, but don't allow it to make us think we can't do great things. That's what Haggai is saying to the people. And I think God says that to us, that we can become kind of discouraged that, wow, I had this glorious past and lots of people and everything. Oh, we don't have that anymore. I'll tell you what, when I look around at you this morning, I see God's glory all over the place. His great glory that he is going to not allow you to keep to yourself, but to continue to encourage us to share more and more. Let me close with this. In fact, if you close your eyes, just ask you to do it just for a moment. I want to read to you our text out of Haggai once more. I want you to hear what God's saying to us. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth. In a little while, I will once more shake the sea and the dry land. In a little while, I will once more shake all nations, and the desired of all nations will come.
Ooh, thank you.
And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. Lord Jesus, fill my house with your glory. Fill each of our houses, our temples with your glory. Fill this place with your glory, this collective corporate body of Ashland Church. Fill us with your glory that people cannot help but see and know and understand that Jesus Christ is who we all ought to be expecting to show up and to fill us with your glory. We move from this place with great expectation. In the name of Jesus our Savior, we pray. Amen. Would you please stand? Join us as we sing, and as we do, if Christ has become real to you for the very first time, I invite you to come to one of the corners of the sanctuary where a prayer team member will be, and you let them know. I don't know how or why or exactly what it means, but Jesus has become become real to me. I want that glory the pastor talked about. I want that in me. I want God to take up residence in me, to clean me up, to forgive me my sin, to guarantee me that I have eternal life with the King of Glory. Let them know that, and they would love to lead you in prayer. If you have somebody you want to pray for who needs to know Jesus, let them know about that. Give them a name if you can, and let them pray for that person. If you have a physical need or financial need or relational need or anything else, where if you have a praise and you want to share the glory of God with someone, come as we sing.
And all those sensing the presence of God's glory say,
Amen. Amen.